So you have built an API which is running on localhost 3000 and you have just finished setting up a fetch call in your front-end application which is running on localhost 4000. But as soon as you run that fetch call, you run into this dreaded error of CORS. Let's see what it is. To understand CORS, we first need to grasp the concept of CrossOrigin Request. In web development, when a web page makes a request for a resource such as an image or data from a different origin, we call it a CrossOrigin Request. An origin is defined by the combination of protocol, domain and port. For example, www.example.com is a different origin than api.example.com. Similarly, localhost 3000 is a different origin than localhost 4000 as the ports are different. By default, web browsers enforce a security policy called the same origin policy. This policy restricts cross-origin requests mainly for security reasons. It prevents scripts running in one origin from accessing resources on the other origin. However, there are situations where we want to relax this policy and allow cross-origin requests. That is where CORS comes in. CORS is a mechanism that enables web servers to declare which origins are allowed to access their resources. It works through a set of HTTP headers exchanged between the client and the server. These headers inform the browser whether it is permitted to make the requested cross-origin request. The main player in CORS is the access control allow origin header. This header is set by the server and specifies which origins are allowed to access its resources. For example, if the server responds with access control allow origin set to www.example.com, it means that only www.example.com is allowed to access the requested resources. But that's not all. CORS also includes additional headers like access control allow methods and access control allow headers. These headers inform the browser about the allowed HTTP methods and headers that can be used in the cross-origin request. These provide fine-grained control over what can be done with the resources. It is important to note that CORS is a client-side mechanism enforced by the web browser. The server needs to handle and respond to the CORS-related headers correctly in order to enable cross-origin access. If the server does not respond with the appropriate headers, the browser will block the cross-origin request. Now let's talk about the different type of CORS requests. There are two: simple requests and pre-flighted requests. Simple requests are HTTP GET and POST requests with certain content types like the form encoded data or the multi-part form data. These requests don't trigger a pre-flight request. On the other hand, pre-flighted requests are more complex. These are triggered when the request method is other than GET or POST and when it includes custom headers. The browser sends an initial options request to the server to check if it is allowed to make the actual request. The server responds with the appropriate CORS headers indicating whether the actual request is permitted or not. Phew, that was a lot of information, but you have made it this far and I'm proud of you. CORS is a vital mechanism that allows web applications to securely interact with resources from different origins. It strikes a balance between security and flexibility, making the web a more dynamic and interconnected place. And that wraps up our friendly yet technical overview of cross-origin request sharing. I hope you found it informative and now you have a clear understanding of how CORS works. If you have any questions or want us to dive deeper into any specific aspect, let us know in the comment section. Don't forget to like this video, subscribe to our channel and hit the notification bell to stay up to date with all of our latest tech content. Thanks for watching and I'll see you guys over in the next video.